thanks for tuning in to Magic TV. I am the guy on the left.
Apparently. And I'm Luis Scott-Vargas.
Fresh back from Nationals. Welcome back, Luis. And was it top 8? No, it was top 16 at Nats? We made it to day 2, right?
Well, yes, but Nationals doesn't have a cut to day 2, so everyone gets to play on day 2.
Okay, well, hey. But you were definitely on day 2, so we got that much.
I was in striking distance of the top 16.
Actually, we were anxiously watching both you and Josh and, of course, Dave Ochoa, Jerry, everyone.
But not for very long.
Yeah.
Some of us.
For some of you, it was about 2 rounds of watching, and for the rest of you, it was kind of a nail-biter down the course.
Right. Nationals didn't go as well as it could have, but I'm not too dissatisfied. I do wish I had chosen a different deck, given what I know now.
Really?
And I think the main problem was that Great Sable Stag really does beat fairies.
That's interesting, because there were a few videos on the website with people, pros, talking about how good Great Sable Stag was against fairies. I don't know if you saw any of those.
Right,
but,
or weren't any of them.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah, and I mean, in testing, we knew it was good, but what I didn't realize is, yeah, there are games where you can beat it. Like, I beat it one game when my opponent goes, turn 3 Great Sable Stag, turn 4 Great Sable Stag.
Wow.
I beat him by playing 2 Scions and Crypting Hand and tapping all his team with Cryptic Command.
Okay.
But I lost some games with fairies that before Sable Stag were unlosable. Like, my first round of the tournament, game 3, my opponent mulls to 5, mm-hmm. doesn't play land on turn 3. Mm-hmm. I'm on the draw, so I go, like, turn 2 Bitter Blossom.
Sure, which is, you know, great.
To turn 4, I Mistbind Click him when he's got 3 lands out. He mm-hmm. lets the click resolve, fallouts to do 2 to the click and kill my tokens. On his turn, he rips a land, plays a land, Lightning Bolts the Mistbind Click. Okay, I mean, at this point, I'm still crushing him. He's got 2 cards in hand. My hand is Cryptic Command, Broken Ambitions, Flash Freeze. Got a Bitter Blossom in play.
Okay.
Next turn he plays a Sable Stag. And then he plays 2 more Fallouts and I die.
Wow.
And before Sable Stag, there was actually just no chance I could lose that
game. Yeah, that was an unlosable board position, right?
Right. And that happened a few times in the tournament. And that was enough to convince me that maybe Fairies wasn't the best choice. The top 8 of the tournament, 32 Sable Stags, 31 Volcanic Falls.
Right. I mean, people were...
Also 31 Reflecting Pools, but that, I think, was more an error than anything else.
Right, right. What about Warnweirding? I mean, I know you had that in there. Did that affect anything at all? Was that just not enough? now the call-in portion of Magic TV.
My car's about to run out of its meter.
All right, well, maybe we should take care of that.
All right. We'll be right back.
Yeah, we'll be
right after these messages. We had a little interruption there with Luis's car. He chased down the meter maid with some foil bitter blossoms. Everything's fine now. Disaster averted. Going back to Nats, if you could do it again, if Nats was tomorrow, what deck would you go with there?
Now, this may seem kind of odd, and I'm actually, my article, which is about to go up, also relates this. Time Sieve is actually, I think, a reasonable deck choice.
You guys like a tier 1 deck? Or is it just a hole in the metagame?
It depends how things shake out. It really can't beat fairies. Like, it's very difficult for it to beat fairies. But if there's going to be a lot of 5cc and a lot of backlash against 5cc, it does well against those decks.
Just seems like any deck choice you go into with a tournament that doesn't play well against fairies, the whole time fairies has been in type 2, that's just a bad idea.
Right,
it's been
right.
A bad idea the whole time.
I think realistically I'd probably sleeve up 5-color control, mm-hmm. but I kind of want to sleeve up time save. Oh, I mean, Olivier Roy made top 8 at French Nats with it. Granted, he didn't win around on the top 8. That's actually a reason I wouldn't play time save, I think, now that I think about it.
Mm-hmm.
If Nationals is a tournament where you want to finish in the top 3.
Right.
Like, at a Pro Tour, obviously you want to win the Pro Tour, but making top 8 at a Pro Tour and losing... Yeah, you get 10K.
Right, you're still happy. Yeah. You're still mission accomplished.
Like, I think Cedric was pretty happy. But
right.
At Nationals, if you lose in the top 8, you get $1,000 and you don't get to be on the team.
Right. It's kind of a booby prize.
At that point, Time Sieve is a kind of deck where if you get the wrong matchup in the top 8, you're done.
Mm-hmm.
Paulo Vitor won his Nationals with fairies. See, fairies.
Fairies.
And he played 2 Time Sieve deck in the top 8, just ended their tournament.
Right. Yeah. Well, it's a bye if you're playing fairies. And they're
pretty close to it, yeah.
Okay. So, Time Sieve maybe, but really 5cc.
Yeah.
And which version would you be leaning towards? Like the Cascade version or like the Waffle Tapa?
Yeah, now called Shuhai because he won Nats with it.
Sure.
All the ones that did well were with Shuhai's, like Broken Ambitions. And
okay. Well, going from Constructed to Draft, M10 draft, a format which you claim to love so much before Nats.
Yeah, before Nats I was a little skeptical about it. Mm-hmm. But as it turns out, it's actually a really good format.
Really? How did things change? I mean, you know, how much practice time did you get in with that? I know we didn't run any drafts here for you.
The thing is, at Nationals, I had a little free time.
True.
And, I mean, tournaments like this, like, tournament's over, you know, we're going to draft till 2 or 3 in the morning. Like,
right.
You can't do drafts at home like this, so you want to do them at events.
Right.
Did quite a few, despite the fact that M10's pretty hard to find. There's just no product there.
Yeah, it's completely, it's like a drought. It's we're a dry world, really, with M10.
Which is good news, because it means M10's doing awesome.
Yeah.
But M10 draft is more complex than I initially thought. There's archetypes, like certain cards which look good, which aren't as good. Like, I drafted a deck which I thought was really good, had a good curve, you know, good finishers, but it didn't have very many spells, mostly creatures.
Mm-hmm.
Just got outclassed by decks with good spells. And Jerry had the same thing happen to him. So, basically, you've got to pay attention to a lot more things than you'd initially think about.
Well, I got some advice from David Mintz, the winner of the last 5K here. He's been doing pretty well in the M10 drafts, and he told me, Mashi, and I'm going to share this with everyone here, the secret to drafting M10 is creatures with evasion and card advantage. Now, how do you feel about that?
I like card advantage and removal myself.
Really? Yeah.
I mean, you do want a finisher. Like, it's pretty important, but like, a deck with a bunch of divinations, cancels, removes souls, and negates, like, that's already a really good start.
Really? You think you can run control in this format? And
yeah, I mean, you got to have some horn turtles and stuff.
Right.
Overall, M10 is pretty good. Like, there are bombs, but they're all, you know, dealable with, and, like, they're all pretty, the format's just really fun to draft.
So your kind of initial cut at this format, was it kind of like, you know, with GP Boston on the horizon, you're like, look, I'm glad they've done this. It's going to open it up to more players. But you seem to be pretty hesitant about the gameplay, the interactions, the complexity.
Sealed's still sealed. Sealed sucks.
Well, I'm not a big fan of sealed in general.
But no, M10 draft's good.
Really? Is there anything you're looking for when you sit down? Or
yeah, Baneslayer Angel.
Yeah. Okay. Great job. Mm-hmm. Strategically, is there anything you're looking for when you sit down? Are there any colors you're leaning towards right now? Or I've seen a lot. Here's the thing. I haven't drafted M10 yet. But we've had tons of drafts in the store, and I look over, you know, people's shoulders while they're drafting the better players, and I see a lot of green-red, and that doesn't seem to be panning out for a lot of people.
No, both me and Jerry had really good green-red decks. Both of us one-tuned. I like white-blue. I like blue-black. I like blue.
Yeah. How about mono-black? That seems to be the
mono-black's good, too.
Yeah?
Well. So, Duress is an underrated card.
So
it's all their bombs.
Really?
Persuasion or Mind Control.
Mm-hmm. Overrun
Fireball. Not Baneslayer.
Yeah,
Baneslayer, okay. You kill with all your other spells.
Okay.
So.
Now, the final little cut at Nats is you did have a tournament on Sunday, a Type 1 tournament.
Yeah, me and David Ochoa from this very site split in the finals for a Lotus and a Mox Jet, which, we were pretty happy with.
So
both playing Tezzeret.
And then while we're on the topic of Type 1, just for all you viewers out there, we are going to revisit the Power 9 stuff.
Right.
We had all the Nats stuff.
Nats seemed a little more time sensitive, and the Power 9 is a pretty big subject, so we want to kind of broach it when we have enough time.
Definitely. I mean, all the feedback, all the comments are great, but it's like there's so much going on there.
Although playing in this Type 1 tournament made me more want to have Power reprinted, because I imagine if this 22-man tournament was a 150-man tournament.
Yeah, it would be much better, right? I mean, you'd have more fun.
Assuming I still won.
Right, exactly. Right. less chance at the prize.
Right.
But I mean, a healthy, more vibrant format would be better.
But yeah, Type 1 was fun.
That's good. And it's always nice when it's, you know, you and Ocho splitting in the finals. You guys both.
Right, despite the fact that round two, I activated Oath of Druids when I didn't have a creature or a Guy's Blessing in my library and decked myself when I had a lethal Darkstone Colossus in play.
Well, I guess that's what makes you a pro then, huh?
So, on that note, we'll let you think about that.
Think about how good Luis is, and should you really be listening to this man for strategy?
But come back next week and check out our next episode of Magic TV.
Thanks for tuning in. Woo!